Laurence Honeyfield is a professional landlord and property investor based in Bristol. In this fascinating podcast episode, he's going to teach us many of the tips and tricks and lessons that he's learned along the way, and hopefully we'll be able to apply it to our own investing careers. As well as that, I'm also involved in a joint venture group based in South Wales, and it's run by a property investment coach called Alex Louise Thomas. If you're interested in finding out more about that, you can go to financialfreedomfilms.com. Also, if you would like to be a guest on the podcast, visit benlowrey.com/podcast guest. And if you would like to be a sponsor on future episodes of this podcast, go to benlowrey.com/sponsorship. Welcome to the call, Laurence.
Can you hear me, Ben?
Yeah, perfectly clear, yeah.
Yeah, that's fine. Yeah, how you going, mate? Okay?
Yeah, thanks for coming on the podcast, Laurence. How's things with you, all right?
Yeah, keeping busy. Funny enough, I was just on speaking to... we're developing 4 properties at the moment, actually, down in Bedminster.
Oh, right.
So I was just talking to Bristol Water then about getting the 4 new supplies in. So, yeah, keeping busy.
Oh, wicked. Well, listen, I don't know a huge amount of detail about what you do, really. So obviously we're going to talk about property, but let's go from the start of the story. Like, when did you first get into property investing? When did you first become a landlord?
Okay, so I was my parents always like invested in property as well. So I was helping manage in a way. What it was, Ben, they bought property, then they put it in my name for tax reasons and things like that. So I had property in my name that rental income was coming into, just as, you know, like parents do, they wanted to help me out as well. So I must admit, I have been lucky in that sense. That what I've been able to achieve has come from a big help, you know, financially from parents as well. In the terms of how it all started, Ben, was back in about, say, 2008, for example. I had a property that my parents gave me. It was mortgage free. Okay, so it was in my name. Now, what people do, if there's no mortgage or anything on their property, you can do what's called, you know, just borrow money against that property, if you like. So you would set up a buy-to-let mortgage. Say your property's worth £200,000 and you think, well, that £200,000 sat in that property is doing nothing. Let's take some money out of that and... you know, let's take, for example, 100,000 out of that. And what would happen there is you'd have a buy-to-let mortgage for £100,000, which the tenants would be paying for through their rent. But you've now got £100,000 that you can like essentially do what you want with. Now, ideally, what you would do is use that as deposits for more property, for example.
I'm with you.
So that's how it all started. I had a property that was left given to me, which had no mortgage on it whatsoever. It was worth, say, about 150. Okay, now, can you remember the credit crunch back in like 2008, 2009, Ben, where everything went wrong financially? What was happening there is... you could really do deals with estate agents, because back then it was what we call a buyer's market, if you like, whereas, you know, the person purchasing had the upper hand, because anything on Rightmove for £200,000, you could really say to the estate agent, you know, this is just going to be sat there. People were very jittery because no one's, you know, people were losing jobs left, right and centre. So people weren't, any money that they had, they weren't going out and buying new property. So whereas I was in the opposite position, I had money and I could take advantage of that. So my strategy basically back then, Ben, was buy as much as I can.
Right, because they were on discount essentially.
Essentially, yeah. Now, if you went into an estate agent now, I'll just tell you very quickly, and it has been like this for the past few years, but with Brexit around the corner, we, again, it might come back a bit, but Basically, if you walk into a state agent, anything for 200 is going for asking price, if not above. Where back then it was me in the driver's seat, I was getting stuff for 20, 30,000 below market value, because of the whole mentality of what it was back then, 2008, 2009. Now, what worked very well then is that I was purchasing property. My first one was the one that I was able to release money from my existing property. I put a £70,000 deposit on another one in Chessels in Bedminster. I had a mortgage for £100,000. Another thing that works well, Ben, is interest rates very quickly. You know, historically, we're at an all-time low, so you can borrow money very cheaply. And on the flip side of that, rental's very high. Now, I don't want to sound greedy or anything like that, but business is business. Now, if someone can lend me £100,000 at 2.5%, and I can go and rent out that property for say £900 a month, £1,000 a month, there's quite a lot of profit in buy to let. Or there certainly was back then. Things have changed slightly, but I will come on to that in a bit. And the government have really put a lot of spanner in the works because, you know, they want to put the brakes on buy to let investors for different reasons. But I will come on to that. But yeah, going back, how it started 2008, 2009, 2010, 2011, I was buying up as much as I can, really, developing as well. So, building stuff, and what was working well, Ben, is that I was building stuff with money I was borrowing out of properties. Going back to my first example, borrowing money from property, and then using that money for developing other properties. Now, what happens then? That development you have, again, it's got 100% equity in. So again, the development. You pull money out the development, you go and buy more. So you kind of, what happens, how you do this, Ben, is you take out like most mortgages are on a fixed or a variable for 2 year, 3 year, or 5 year. Now, what happens is that say you buy a property, and again, this is where I got very lucky with the market, that the property I was buying for 170,000, for example, in 2 years' time, that property had become about 260,000 because I was buying at a very low, and then we came out of the recession. People could start affording more, you know, talking about say 2011, 2012, 2013. So what happened to the if you look at it is on a graph, if you can picture a graph, for example. 2008, you're towards the bottom, and then, you know, coming up, you're going up to 2012, 13, 14, 15. It was a very steep rise, bringing it back to what we called the pre-crash prices, if you like, property. So essentially, what I was doing, I was letting the market help me. So the market was adding value. Because the market was coming back as we were coming out of the recession, the market was adding value to my property. So every 2 years, I was remortgaging them at the new value of the property at 75% of the new value. Now, what that was essentially letting me do is take in per property, remortgage them, and getting about, say, 20, 30, 40,000 pound out of each property. And then with those, you know, they build up when they all add up. You know, say you've got 10 properties and you take £20,000, £30,000 more out of each property every 2 year. You use that money then for your deposits on more. So I was in a very, and I to be honest, Ben, when these prices were rising, I could not really believe what was happening. For example, that first property I bought for £170,000 in Bedminster in 2009, 10 years later, where we are now, it's worth £400,000.
Bloody hell.
So you can see that property not only has it increased over 100%, I've been renting it out for the last 10 years. You know, you're not going to get that return on the stock market, or certainly you won't leaving that money in the bank. So I've been lucky on two accounts, really. The market has, you know, come out of the recession and the values have increased, but also interest rates have been kept at a very, you know, low rate for financial reasons. But from my point of view, I'm always keeping an eye on, you know, interest rates, market values. I'm always on Rightmove checking where rentals go in, where house prices are going, because, you know, if you really study the market and you really understand, you know, the organism of how it's working, you are at an advantage. But like with any business, I presume.
That's incredible. And also, I wanted to ask, you said you were developing. So what kind of work were you doing? Were you sort of adding extensions or were you building from scratch? What exactly did you mean?
Yeah, well, what it was a property that I owned, for example. If it had like a lean-to to it, which the example, if I give you the first development I did, it was just a, you know, a normal end terraced house with a garage on the side, which I used to rent that garage bit out, but it became very unsafe in there. So I could see the size of the land. Then I thought, well, hang on a minute. It's a bit like now people, you know, if they've got a big garden, for example, they might say, right, okay, we don't need all this size. We'll put a house here. We'll go and get planning permission, put a house on the side, sort of thing. You know, I know people do that as well. But basically, I had an old lean-to that was obviously very unsafe. Not fair for people to rent it out for health and safety reasons. So I approached my you know, architect and said, like, what do you think the chances are? So where that lean-to was earning, you know, say £400 a month just through rental, we put two, what was it? No, it was a one bed flat and a two bed flat on top. And again, example, Ben, you know, that cost me 150,000 to do that development. Each flat now is worth about 240 grand. That development was done back in 2011, and then each property rents out for, I think, around about, yes, about £900 a month. So what I would say, you know, it's a bit developing, Ben, it is more involved, and you need, you're working with more people, you know, you need a bit more knowledge of, you know, different things. It's certainly, you know, with a buy to let, you buy a property, you know, you approach your estate agent, you set up the tenancy, and then that's it. You know, developing, obviously, you've got solicitors involved, where you have with other stuff, but really, you know, you're working with architects, you're working with building control, you're working with Bristol City Council, and then you've got to develop the thing. Which is can be stressful as well, but you know, once it's done, you know, you reap the rewards there. But it is getting the land. You know, you try and get anything around Bedminster or in these good areas, you're up against the big lads as well. You know, they've probably put a bid or secured it months before you even become aware that it's available. So,
What kind of houses would you stay away from, or what kind of properties would you stay away from? Like, if you were, say, you were speaking to someone who's new today and they were interested in buying an investment property in that area, what advice would you give them?
Oh right, okay. So you I know you're a fan of Grant Cardone, Ben, aren't you? Yes. Now, as you no doubt are aware, that he is, you know, he's very up in that. I think he's something like 1,000 properties or something, isn't it?
Something,
Something crazy. And he I like what he said, is that when you go into a development, or you're going to do a viewing and get that feel of it. So if I tell you what I would look for, that might answer your question indirectly. So if I go to location's key, so will it rent well? Bedminster North Street, everyone seems to want to live there, Southfield, they call it the Little Clifton. So anywhere that looks like it's built up, so you'll have all your cafes around there, your amenities. If you're close to certain rail links, Temple Meads, if you're close to bus stops, things like that, if it get a feel of, do you think it's quite a vibrant area that someone would, sometimes I use the analogy that would I want to live here? Do you see what I mean, Ben? Certainly, if I was renting, is this something that I would want to stay in? Is this the location? So yeah, it has to, you have to, going back to Grant Cardone, he always says that it has to feel right for him. I've done viewings with estate agents and then I've walked away and thought, well, yes, it's quite nice, but it has to, if you're going to be spending, quarter of a million on something, it has to have feel exactly right. But I've been lucky, I location for me is massively important. And see, what I would avoid, and I'm not being snobby here, is that, lower end areas, for example, because I just think, that's not the sort of property I'd rather pay a bit more for the better quality of property, hoping to get the better quality of tenants. That doesn't always happen, mine. And that's another thing, the thing that I've learned over the years, that one of the major things that you have to do, Ben, is get, once you've got good tenants, you're laughing, because once the tenants are in, it's very difficult. Obviously you go through court and things like that. So yeah, it's massively important to get good quality of tenants.
Do you have an agent managing it for you, or do you do it yourself?
No, I've been approached many times, Ben, but and I think maybe eventually I will go down that avenue. But at the moment, thing is with agents, Ben, they take 10% of your rent. Now, when you've been doing it, I've been doing this for about, say, 12 years now, that take one property, for example, that you rent out, say, for £1,000 a month, they would take £100 every month, regardless if anything goes wrong. Now, what happens, Ben, is that I manage all of them, and people say, well, isn't that hard work? Well, not really, because one property, you'll probably get a phone call from your tenants twice a year that, oh, Lawrence, there's a bit of mold appearing here, or what do I have this morning? I had to sort two things out this morning. Oh, your extractor fan isn't working properly, there's a mold appearing in the bathroom. And the other one was it was an electrical issue. But honestly, Ben, it goes back to, again, trying to get the right property. But generally you'll get a phone call, say, twice, three times a year maximum per property. So, from my point of view, that it doesn't justify, and I always buy property that, I can get to. I don't buy far afield. Everything's in Bristol. It's easy for me to manage myself. And another thing is, well, if you've got a good team around you, which would be my advice as well, it only takes a phone call. So if you are going to get into buy to let invest in on a relatively larger scale, you want a reliable team around you, that is from your mortgage broker right up to the tradespeople you're going to be using. If you've got a gas issue, then you need a good gas engineer, a good plumber, electrical issue, carpenter, things like that. And it only takes one phone call. I give them the keys, I drop the keys into them, I can meet them on site, anything like that. So, well, with the estate agents managing and managing companies, I do know people who obviously use them, but what they would do, Ben, they would have like a big portfolio, but they might live abroad, you know. So, you know, for them to come back from Spain or anything just to check a leak in tap, it doesn't make sense. I can't justify paying all that money every month for just a few issues 2 or 3 times a year. So at the moment, yes, I am doing it myself.
Yeah, fair enough. Also, something else I was wondering, when you buy, are you looking for things that need a lot of work, that are dilapidated, or things that have got the potential for extension and development? Is that your criteria?
Again, that comes down to strategy. That if that is your strategy, there's nothing wrong with that whatsoever, and it can be very profitable. You know, buy something like you say that needs a bit of work, spend 10, 15, 20 grand on it, and you can do what they call, you know, flip it. You've heard that term, Ben? Yeah. So that's one strategy. I have done in the past, not many. Mine is mainly, you know, buy them. Hardly need any work whatsoever and just get them rented. But you know, there's nothing wrong with that if that is what you wanted to do. But yeah, what I tend to like buying, Ben, at the I have done recently are the new build flats. Because what happens with that, say you were to go and buy a house, you know, you see a typical house that you see around Bedminster or Brislington, anywhere like that, 1930s, that, you know, you will get more issues with them, you know, things like roof leaks and things, everything like that, where it was taking up quite a lot of my time and it's very expensive as well. So what I like to go for now is new build stuff because you'll get the 10-year warranty, you see. So you'll notice a lot of new stuff going up around Bristol, and I think over in Wales as well, there's a lot of stuff going up. So that's quite nice, I would say, for your new person who, not necessarily new, but maybe had a job as well and just wanted a bit of passive income and thought, well, I've got money here, it's not doing anything in the bank, I don't want to go down the stock market avenue. But let's buy something new build. Now, when I say new build, Ben, you know, generally that would be flats, but let's not say it couldn't be houses as well. And then, see, the beauty with doing buy to let is what you're trying to aim for is once you've bought it, you never hear from your tenants again. So, what I like about new build stuff, and I bought two last year. On Coronation Road,
I know, yeah.
yeah, a new development, the Bankside development there, and the beauty of that is, if anything was to go wrong, I wouldn't have to pay any money out for the first 10 years. It's down to the developer. Do you see what I mean?
Yeah.
The developer takes up out their own insurance, so that's quite a good strategy for, you know. For those reasons, like I said, if you had enough of having to go and fork out quite a lot for houses being repaired, or if you were new to the game, or if you just wanted to do it as a bit of passive income, well, I think what one thing they do say, Ben, is you know the capital appreciation of property. They kind of say flats don't appreciate quite as well. So, you know, I think the theory is that flats can, there's so many of them and they can be put anywhere, sort of thing. Whereas if you've got like a nice Victorian house somewhere, I've noticed that out of my portfolio, say over the last 10 years, if I look at the increase based on Rightmove and Zoopla and things like that, and estate agents would tell you the same thing. They would both rent very well. So flats and houses, you get no issues, and well, one's not necessarily better than the other. But again, if your strategy was I want it as part of, say, a pension plot sort of thing, I just wanted to, over the next 20 years, hopefully get that property, go in value a lot more, maybe look at houses over flats. But it comes down to preference, Ben,
I see.
strategy, things like that.
So the new builds are going to give you less hassle in terms of maintenance and stuff, but presumably a slightly less return, am I right?
Yes. For some reason, that's what they're kind of saying. But to be honest with you, Ben, I've bought relatively new build, and that's gone up quite a lot in value as well. So I think it works well on all count. Like I said, the main thing with new build is that peace of mind that for the first 10 years you get, what they call that warranty. That works well.
And in terms of finding things, how do you do it? Do you just look on Rightmove, or do you go into estate agents as well, or is it like, how does that work? Is there kind of tricks, like insider tricks, way of finding things?
Certainly there is. There's I think I tried added you, Ben, to like the Progressive Property Community.
Oh, I don't know. Did it? Is that on Facebook? Is it?
I'll try adding you again.
I'll have another look.
You've got your basic ways of, make yourself known as an investor. So you would go into an estate agent's, "Hi, I'm Ben Lowrey. This is me. This is what I'm looking to do." If you can come across credible, to the estate agents, leave all your contact details, go on their mailing lists for emails, and just say, "Look, anything new comes along," or tell them what you're after. So get yourself known to the estate agents just by going in and having a chat and leaving all your contact details. Driving around, having a look at, I always tend to drive around Bedminster or Bristol and take like different routes and things like that on the way to go in places and see what new for sale signs you can see. There are also, what people call like deal packagers. So you could, there's people out there that they make money from, that they source property for you, Ben. Do you see what I mean? So you could say to me, say I was a deal packager, and I was, this is what I did. You would phone me up and explain what you were looking for, and I would have a lot of knowledge of certain areas. So all over the UK, you'll get people who are, and what you would do, I think, how they make their money, Ben, is that you would pay them what, like a finder's fee sort of thing.
Have you ever
Like a,
done that? Have you paid people like that?
no, I've been, I've, how I've just got my property is just through driving around, seeing boards outside. Because, like I said, it comes down to location a lot of the time, whether you're going to rent somewhere. The location has to be right. So I would drive around those locations I know that work well. Or if I'm on Rightmove, I would just search BS3 or anything like that. I haven't needed to do that. I think it the only time I would approach someone like that, Ben, is if it was out of an area that I had no knowledge of, say, up north, say Newcastle, for example. I wouldn't have a clue, what I was looking for in terms of prices, location. So then you would approach someone like that, I presume.
Right, I'm with you. Yeah. Have you ever received a finder's fee, like for a property that was interesting, but you didn't want to buy it and somebody else did?
I've done that a lot. I've had estate agents phone me and say, "Look, Lawrence, we've got this at X amount. Do you want to buy it?" And I've turned them down, but I've sold it to people I know who are investors.
Right, I see. And they give you a kickback or something.
Kind of, yeah. But to be honest, Ben, I don't take any money. Like, say I pass it on to you, I don't take money off of you. I wouldn't take money off of you to find you something. And again with the estate agent, but you just become more credible, that you're like the go-to person, if you like, who either will buy it or know someone. I've helped people, going back to when we started at the beginning about equity release, I spoke to people who didn't even have a clue what equity release was and things like that. So help people, and I've took them through the stages, and I've sat down in meetings with my mortgage broker with them, and I've taken them up there, and we've gone step through step, and I've helped them buy their first property. For me, it's just giving back. I've done well from property, so for me, it's just nice to help other people do it as well.
That's very nice. Well, that's what you're doing with this podcast, really, isn't it? You're sort of giving your time just to give out some tips and guidance for me and anybody listening.
Yeah. Now, all I was going to say very quickly as well, Ben, is that this has been going very well recently, but there's been a lot of new tax laws that have come into play as well. See, what people tend to do now when they're buying new properties, they're buying them through limited companies.
I was going to ask you that. Is all your stuff within a company?
No, for initially it was done through my own name. So you just do your end of year tax return. But what's happened now, the government have said come 2020, you are no longer allowed to offset all of your mortgage interest. It's not very fair because, like any business, take a carpenter for example, it's a bit like the government saying all those tools that you've been buying each year, come 2020, you can no longer offset any of those expenses against your profit. Tradespeople will be up in arms. Now, what they're kind of saying is exactly the same. Now, they're trying to say that buy to let isn't a business. You're doing this as a sideline luxury in a way. But we're arguing, well, hang on a minute. No, we're doing this as a business. But anyway, what they couldn't get it passed when everyone objected. So what's happened now is it is going ahead. But to be honest, Ben, your mortgage interest, if you're borrowing quite a lot of money to buy all these properties, you are going to have a very big bill for your mortgage interest. Now, that works okay because you offset it against your profit. But come 2020, obviously that'd be taken away. And it works out, you will actually be paying tax on profit on a figure that it actually isn't profit.
You can pay more in tax than you're making in profit, can't you?
Exactly. And you're not being taxed fairly. So what, let's for example, the last two properties I purchased, I never bought them in my own name. I've bought them in through the limited company. The advantage of the limited company is basically that law doesn't apply.
I was going to ask you, what did you do to deal with all this? Like, did you were you tempted to sell some to reduce your borrowing and reduce the impact?
You are right. So what happens, they set up barriers so you work ways around it. Now, my first strategy was, okay, all these properties that are in my own name, let's move them all into a limited company. Okay. Now, that would have been great. However, there is a huge capital gains tax bill to pay because effectively, Ben, what you're doing, you're selling properties that are in your name, your sole name, to your limited company. Although limited company, you're a director, HMRC see it as a sell. Now, going back to my first example of one property bought for 170 is now worth 400, capital gains at 28%.
Jesus Christ, is it that much?
Oh yes,
Oh
that's
fuck. So if you sell that into a limited company, you're going to get stiff for like, oh, I don't know, what, 50 odd grand?
no. Well, yeah, exactly. Well, I had eight properties in my own name. To move them into a limited company was going to cost me 90 grand. So, that didn't work. So what we've kind of said now is, okay, keep them existing ones in your name. Any future purchases, you purchase through your limited company.
It's horrendous, isn't it? It's a hell of a whack, isn't it, that?
Yeah, it is, Ben. And like you said, before like, are you going to be reducing your mortgages? Certainly, because before it was good to have it was good to have your mortgage interest because you can offset it. So I was reluctant to pay off mortgages because for that reason. Whereas now there's no advantage whatsoever, so you may as well start paying them off and reducing them. And again, where are we going to be in 5 years' time with interest rates? We don't know. So
Yeah,
that would
really
a
chucks
long.
the spanners in the works, doesn't it?
What they were saying, Ben, is that going back to what you were saying about new builds and things like that, a developer would buy. Build these new builds, say Wapping Wharf, for example. First-time buyers would come along and think, "Oh, I like that. I wouldn't mind purchasing here." And the estate agent would turn around and say, "Sorry, that's gone. That's sold, or that's sold." And what they were saying is that investors were buying up a lot of the new build stuff. And it wasn't fair on, first time buyer. That was an argument that I heard because I was like, well, why are they doing this? And it was really to slow up the buy-to-let investors taking everything. But, there's arguments for and against that.
Yeah, it's annoying, isn't it? Because really, there's nothing we can do about it, is there? It's a case of, damage limitation, choosing the best strategy to deal with it, really, isn't it? It's like the
They will set this out, and then all you do, if you can work out, I'm very mathematical anyway. You've got to enjoy maths, I think, and because what was happening, Ben, if I give you a very example, in the past, it was if you had £50,000, if I said to you, Ben, what would you do? Would you pay off a mortgage at 2.5%? Pay 50 grand off of, say, 150 grand mortgage, or would you use that 50 grand as a deposit on a new property? Well, going back before these laws came in, it was a no-brainer. You would use 50 grand as a deposit for a new property because you could earn through that new property more than 2.5%. Whereas now it's all changed. And another thing as well, Ben, is that anything I buy going forward, because I own more than one property, I also have an increase in stamp duty. I pay a stamp duty higher rate than anyone who was going to buy their first property.
Is that just properties in your name, or does that also apply to stuff in the limited company?
It applies to stuff. If I was to buy them in the limited company, it doesn't matter. The fact they would say, no, you've got property in your name, so you can't get around it, basically, whatever you go through. So again, that is a new thing that the government's brought in to slow up buy to let investing, saying nope, anything more than one property. Again, that was a law, Ben, that's only come in over the last couple of years. So you can see that they are, gradually bringing different things in to slow it up.
You at the start of the conversation, you mentioned a development you're currently working on. Can you tell us about that?
Yeah, so what it is where my dad's trailer site was, Ben, down
On the
Winchester Road
corner, yeah.
on the corner there. That obviously dad's finished off down there that over the last few years. So what we've got is what was our offices. It's a bit like a commercial conversion, if you like. There was a remember the sandwich shop on the corner as well. There was a little,
Vaguely.
yeah. So what it was where dad's offices were, if you like. So what we're kind of doing there is converting that into two houses and two flats. So you would again the strategy would be is get your architect in. Look at the sizes there, have a look what we could put there. Once he's done the drawings, get that over to Bristol City Council planning for approval. Now that can take 9 weeks. If you get the okay on that, off you go. So we We're probably about 2 months into the build down there.
All right.
Yeah, and hopefully, probably got, it's still early doors down there, but say another 12 months, things should be coming towards the end.
Can you give any advice on, I imagine, the planning permission process? A lot of it rests on that, doesn't it? Have you got any tips for choosing an architect or how to deal with the council? Was that a big learning curve for you?
It kind of was. I don't really, if you get a good architect, that they should be doing all the approach in the council, and it's not, you wouldn't do that would be done through your architect. So you can go on these different websites now, like Trust a Trader and things like that, or word of mouth, maybe, people who've used good people get speaking to other developers and find out who they've used. But no, getting a good architect is key as well. But we just done it through, I think it was just through word of mouth, Ben. Someone recommended this person and we used him, and we've been using him for quite a for the last, say, 10 years now. But yeah.
Something I was going to, I'm also I'm conscious of your time, Lawrence. I know you got to get going, you got stuff to do. Have you got a little bit more time? Or?
Yeah, I got about, say, 10 minutes. That's okay.
All right. Yeah, something else I was going to ask you. When you bid or put in an offer, do you bid aggressively? Like were you always put in a low offer? How do you do that?
Yeah. Well, if I give an example, I was. It's an interesting debate, really, because if you take an example for a property that's, say, worth £200,000, the best seat to be in is if you're not too worried whether you get it or not. So I would look at lots of properties, say about 20, and then across the board put in lower offers and hope that someone w will bite, if you like.
Oh, I see. So it's like a numbers game. You put in loads of sort of fairly low bids, and then one of them might be a deal.
It all comes down at the end of the day, and the motivation of the seller, and also the market. Remember, we were going back at the beginning of the conversation, 2009, 2010. You are in the driver's seat, where you've got to be a bit careful now with lowball offers, because I put a lowball one in last week on a property, and it was 315,000. I said about two, I'd go up to 290. It went for 305. So, I would never put in asking price. Same as if I was selling a property, I would, I'd be quite happy if it went for asking price. There's always going to be, I think, some form of negotiation, but it comes down to, Ben, at the end of the day, location. If it's a popular location, you've got less wiggle room. Okay, if you're looking at areas that aren't so popular, then okay, fair enough. Another strategy I use, Ben, is find out how long it's been on the market for.
Right.
So ask questions. You can go on Rightmove and it'll tell you the date that it was listed.
Right.
If you've got a property that's been on the market for 6 months,
Yeah.
you've got a little bit of an advantage over something that was just come on the market last week.
Right. And what do you consider a low ball? Like, is 10% low, or is 5%, or is 20%? Like, what do you mean?
Again, it's market conditions. It this, say, 2019, where we are, this whole thing with Brexit, there's a little bit of uncertainty, but things are still kind of moving. But something that was, say, for £300,000, my first entry would probably be around, because I think there is a bit of uncertainty, and with the housing market at the moment. I would go in, say, about, say, 270, 275. There is a bit of a fine line, Ben. You don't want to, say, come in too aggressive, because people just think, well, you're just wasting our time here. If an estate agent phoned you up and said, well, Look, Ben, you've got it up here for 300. Someone wants to offer you 250. Sometimes it can be seen as a bit of insulting as well. So you've got to be a little bit careful. So, something reasonable, but reasonably aggressive as well. And then you just start from there. But certainly 10% below is viable, I would say.
Right. So as a rule of thumb, 10% is not unusual then.
Oh no. And again, going back to it, if it's been on Rightmove for 12 months, 10% would be the minimum I'd be going in. I'd be going in probably more aggressive than that.
What's your favorite deal you've ever done? Is there one you're particularly fond of that was
Yeah, there is. And that is the first one I ever done. And that is the one where back in 2008, 2009, I had no knowledge whatsoever, Ben, of what I was doing. I'd done so many viewings. I knew the area, being Bedminster, was quite a good rental area, but I didn't know in terms of do I go for a two up, two down? Do I need a bathroom upstairs? Is gardens important and things like that? You kind of, the more you do it, you kind of know what's more important, Ben, in terms of what tenants are looking for. But no, going back to then 2009, I was just totally new to all of it. Knew I wanted to get into it. Probably did about 30 viewings, and the only reason I picked the house that I did, which was turned out to be the best one, is just down to the condition of it. It was tidy, but I didn't know, back then what I knew now. That was I buying? Was it all laid out in the right way and things like that? It was just purely based on it look nice. But that is the one that I use the example that I paid for 170 and is now worth about £400,000.
Do you do HMOs or do you just rent the whole thing out?
HMOs are good, and I know a lot of people that do them. I don't, because they're a bit more involved, Ben. For me, I like to buy something, put them on a tenancy agreement for at least 6 months, preferably 12, and then job done. HMOs are, first of all, they have to be set up in a certain way. There's more regulations on HMOs. And then obviously, you've got the tenants coming and going a bit more.
I
There's a bit
see.
more hands-on in terms of, and to be honest, Ben, that's not what excites me, keeping an eye on tenants coming and going. It's more back then it was doing the deals and things like that.
Right. And another thing, is there a certain etiquette in terms of like if you see a for sale sign on a house, will you go and knock on the door and speak to whoever's there, or are you supposed to go to the agent?
You can do, Ben, but they're in contract.
Oh.
So I've got a for sale sign outside my house. You come and knock on my door, okay, and say, look, Lawrence, I'll give you asking price. Don't worry about your estate agent. You don't have to pay him the fees. Now, what would happen then in that example? I would say phone your estate agent up and say, thank you, Ocean. Thank you, CJ Hull. I've sold it. And they will say, that's all very well, but you signed the terms of the agreement. Any sell, even if you sold it to a family member, anything like that, they would still take their commission, or because you are in contract with them for 6 months.
But even so, would you go and actually knock on the door just to have a quick look, like just to save time?
It's not the right thing to do.
Okay.
If you phoned up an estate agent, and generally what they do is phone the person selling the house. And then they will want at least 24 hours, okay?
Right.
If you just turned up and knocked on the door and said, can I have a quick look around, they're not going to be too happy.
Right, so it's not really the done thing then.
No, they're no doubt there are people out there. In a day, no one wants to pay an estate agent if they can get away with it. But that is, I don't know how I knew that. I think I did a very similar thing a few years ago. Or I think I might have been selling a house, Ben, and I had the for sale sign out there, someone approached me, if you like,
Yeah.
and said, I'll buy it off you. Don't worry about the estate agent. So I made the call, and that is when they said, no, sorry, we don't care who it is. You have signed here that we've got rights to sell to that property for the next 6 months. So
I see, yeah.
think that's how I found out about that.
This just before we finish, Lawrence, is there any other important thoughts like you wanted to mention that we haven't mentioned yet?
Not really. I suppose I would just say to people that want to get into it is, do your due diligence. Make sure you learn about different things because, that there you hear about all the good stuff, but people don't always talk about the stuff that can go wrong. But it is out there, Ben. It's not as easy as, you watch Homes Under the Hammer and they make it look so easy and stuff like that.
Yeah.
But you do have to be careful. One thing I would say as well is any people looking to get into it, what's helped me is having a good team around me. So that can be from your solicitor, your mortgage broker, all the way through to your tradespeople, estate agents that you can trust well most of
Yeah.
the time. And then certainly go for it, but just do a bit of research, read a few different books, listen to different podcasts. There's good stuff on YouTube out there. And yeah, certainly go for it, but just be careful as well.
One other thing, have you ever had to evict anybody and go through the court process?
Nearly, Ben. Nearly. Yeah, it was an issue with a property, and I had two tenants that moved down from Manchester, and it, at the beginning everything was going very well, and then all of a sudden the rent stop coming in, and then it was why aren't you paying me? Well, we haven't got a job. Well, go and get a job then. Well, there's nothing out there. Well, there was and stuff like that. And this is what I said to you at the beginning, Ben. One of the most important thing is if you're getting involved in buy-to-let investing is try do the best you can to suss your tenants out before they move in. Because it is difficult because they are very clever as well, tenants. They were playing the game with me that they knew that unless they owed me more than I think 8 weeks, there was nothing I could do about it.
Right.
So they were paying just enough and things like that. Laws may have changed back then. Now, sorry, but it is a process getting them out because what people kind of say is, although it's your house, law are often favouring towards the tenant once they're in there. And yes, you can get them out, but we're going to make it difficult for you to do it because they don't want people going homeless and things like that and things like that. And so but that is one thing that was difficult. And it is hard to work out. For example, I have three teachers moving a property and and you think, well, respectable job. The estate agent have done all their checks on them. But until they actually live in your property, it's very difficult. They do all these reference checks and stuff like that. So really, you are keeping your fingers crossed that they will look after it. And yeah, they were absolutely useless. But I thought, yeah, they'll be okay. Yeah, okay, we'll get these in down there. Is what I tend to do as well, Ben. Another bit of advice is when you first get new tenants in there, just to make sure that they know that you are on the ball. You would say to them, look, guys, the procedure of what I do is, I don't know you. You've never lived in properties of mine before. for the first year, I come down, say, after 3 months, I'll pop down, and then after 6 months, and then annually after that. And it puts in their mind, well, hang on a minute, this guy, he's pretty on the ball here. And then all you've got to say is, look, you'll get 24-hour notice, either through text or a letter, however you want it. That's all you can do, really, is just try to make them think that. And another thing as well, if the place is kept really nice before they move in, I always make sure it's absolutely spotless, because then they think, well, hang on a minute, we're moving into a property. And then you just make it clear to them, this is how you want it kept, and this is the procedure. You will be down here for the just to keep things checked, not babysit them or anything like that, but just let them know that, that this is what you do for a job, and this is how you want it kept, really.
So, although you said you don't use agents to manage the property, you do use them to find tenants, do you, and do the vetting?
The only involvement I have with estate agents is at the end of a tenancy. If I've got a tenant moving out, then I would put it back on the market with an estate agent.
Right.
Because that way, I think it gets it more. I've done it through Gumtree. I've even done it through Facebook, anything there. But then, people go into an estate agent. They've got to be reference checked. They're going to be, it just makes it a little bit more official. From the day one, they're thinking, no, this isn't just some private landlord who just wants to make a little, just get people in, desperately get people in. This is done properly here. But once they're in, I get the tenancy agreements myself, and you can download them. So say you moved into a property, Ben, after 12 months, I would phone you up, say about a month before, say, look, Ben, do you want to renew it? As you probably know. And if you said yes, I would then come down with my tenancy agreements and do it with you. So I don't use the estate agent to renew them, because they charge you quite a lot of money just to do that. Whereas it takes me 5 minutes to download a form and pop down there. So, but the initial one is, yeah, I do it through them just to make it look a bit more official as well.
That's really interesting, Lawrence. That's really helpful. Thanks ever so much for explaining all that to us.
Yeah, but anytime they, but if you ever want to get into it or know anyone, I like I said, I've helped other people buy buy-to-lets, and I'm always happy to help and give back.
Yeah, that's great. I'm hoping to get into it. That's one of the reasons I moved over to Wales, because it's a bit more accessible over here.
Yeah, I've heard the market's very good over there. I've considered it, Ben, but the only thing that holds me back is, like I was saying to you earlier, I can keep an eye on everything, 5 minutes down the road. But no, I think you're in a good position. Wells, I've heard it is very, very good for investing at the moment. I think I know a few people that might be going over to that area. So, but yeah, if you ever need any more advice, just give me a shout anytime.
Yeah, fantastic. We'll stay in touch. I'll keep you updated with what I'm doing.
Yeah, brilliant. Nice one,
All
Ben.
right, Lawrence, thanks very much.
Cheers, buddy.
See ya.
Bye-bye.
Bye.
Bye.